pledge allegiance to the Christian flag, so we don't need a mic for that. So let's just start with pledge allegiance to the flag.
Thank you, Lord. Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you, Lord.
And then we're going to do the pledge of allegiance to our Christian flag.
Thank you, Lord.
I pledge allegiance to the gracious flag, who holds the kingdom of stands, one Savior is crucified, and coming again with life, and liberty to all who believe. Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Little different start to this morning. Again, the pastor will be out here presently. But I want to welcome each and every
one. Thank you, Jesus.
This beautiful morning that we have, this Memorial Day and service that we're going to have.
Thank you, Lord.
I just ask that you continue to pray.
Thank you, Lord.
In earnest. The devil fights God's people.
Thank you, Lord.
It's on the horizon.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
In the end, we win.
Amen.
We can't get discouraged.
Yes.
The way.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen. Amen.
We're soldiers.
Thank you, Jesus.
That's what God called us to be. The battle is
a spiritual
battle. We will prevail.
Yes, amen. Lord. Yes, Lord.
We're going to go ahead and get started with our prayer request.
Thank you, Lord.
Let's get started this morning. Thank you, Lord.
I do. And we're praying for my ex, John. He's back in the hospital again. We had a couple of temperatures. He's pretty sick. And he has a UTI. Hopefully they can correct that. He's having seizures as well. So he does need your prayers. My dad's foot's swollen again. And no way double because it was doing better. So I just believe that the Lord can take care of this. My children, my family, their salvation as well.
Amen. Let's go next. Testimony, my wife had a little illness this weekend, and but the Lord saw her through, and you know, we all have issues from time to time, but again, we can call upon the Lord. He's faithful to us, no matter what we're going through. I have lost loved ones myself, brothers, children. I have two uncles, one in California, one in South Carolina. Both of them have cancer. One of them has two kinds of cancer. Talked to him just last weekend, I think it was, the middle of last week. And he said, you know what? He said, I feel pretty good. He said, I was where I couldn't even walk. He said, the Lord saw me through. He said, and now, he said, he's been out planting the garden and whatnot, working around the yard and things like that. The Lord's faithful. And call upon him and trust him for each and every need that we have. Pray for the church. Pray for our gathering tonight. That the Lord will be in the midst of each and everything that we do here at this church. He's blessed us this far, and I'm sure He's going to continue that way. And
amen.
We're faithful to Him.
We
study in Sunday school in Ezekiel and Jeremiah and whatnot. They got away from the Lord. And the Lord had to bring judgment on them. I don't want to experience the Lord's judgment. I want to be in that blessing, in that abundant supply that He has for me. I want Him to be on my side. And we have to, it's all contingent upon us. We make those choices. There's a wise woman before I even knew the Lord told me, it's all about the choices you make and I make as to how the Lord deals with us through this walk of life. Let's go to them. Heavenly Father, we just come before you, Lord God. We want to thank you and praise you, Lord. You're just so good to us, Lord. The blessings, Lord, are abundant, Lord. And your spirit, Lord, is up here this morning, Lord. We know, Lord, that you'll tend to your children, Lord. You're faithful, Lord. And all, and we just ask, God, that you'll place upon all hearts to be faithful, also, Lord. Those that are sick and afflicted, Lord God, we ask, God, that you'll speak healing into their spirits, Lord. Lift them up, Lord God, to the throne of grace, Lord. Where we know, Lord God, that you continue to perform that each and every affliction that they have, the trials and things that we go through in this walk of life, Lord. We know, Lord God, that one day it'll come to an end. But we have to be obedient, Lord, and trust you, Lord. we have to have you first and foremost in our life, and not put nothing before you. God bless those that are seeking salvation today, Lord. Touch each and everything we say and do here at this church house, God, that it honors and glorifies you. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
Good morning.
Morning.
Good to be in the house of the Lord on this Memorial Day, and we want to do a little something different this morning. We're thankful for those who served. I've heard me here and talk this morning. I personally have never lost anybody that has gone. I have several uncles that have served, but my family's blessed. We've never lost anyone, and I'm sure that many have, but we just want to give honor to the Lord today.
Amen.
I love Him. I'm thankful for this country. I can't always say that I'm proud of it or what it's become, but I'm proud of who it's founded on.
Amen.
And we want to start today. We want to say the Pledge of Allegiance to our flag. Yeah. Oh, you guys did that? Okay. I'm sorry, I'm coming in late, okay? Did you sing America?
No. Yeah.
All right, we're going to sing America. Ezra. You can't go to Grandpa right now. Yeah. Is it on the screen? There you go. Okay, everybody got a hymn. It's page 51. We're going to do the first verse of the fourth verse.
Oh,
field, keeping on the firing line. You recognize that we're in a battle. The battle is raging, and unfortunately, I think too many Christians aren't recognizing the fact that there is a battle and that we're in one. Souls are at stake. The costs are high. There's something worth fighting for. I think, though, that the church too often, I look back to David and when he went to check on the battle, and the Philistines were there in the valley and taunting and blaspheming God and doing everything else, and Israel's army was hiding in the mountains behind the rocks. They recognized there was a battle, but nobody was there fighting. Took one little shepherd boy to come along. His brothers got mad at him. And he said, what? Is there not a cause? Is there not a reason? Listen, church, the battle's raging, whether you're hiding behind the rocks on the mountainside or sitting at home not doing a thing about it. The battle's on, and it's hot, and it's heavy. And more than anything, we need soldiers to engage in the battle. Don't turn your back. Don't close your eyes. Don't hide your head in the sand or whatever it is that we're doing. We need to acknowledge and see what's taking place and take part in the battle. Amen. We want to bless the Lord this morning with our tithes and offerings that come.
Into the church and just continue to bless us, Lord, and we have your way in these services for Jesus.
Amen.
He never left me either.
talks about all of his provision. We talked about that in Sunday school this morning. He has an abundant supply of his provision. Amen. I thank the Lord for that.
Amen.
The other day I picked up my paper. Let me tell you what the paper said. Some born and quit professor been teaching that God was dead. Well, he must have been one of Baal's prophets from back in Elijah's time. Cause everywhere I look around my house, I can see his sign. Well, God's not dead.
So much more behind what it's all about. It's when we remember, we're supposed to, those that have gone on before us, that they gave their lives for what we take for granted.
Right. Amen.
Trample all over.
It's the truth.
Trash.
It's the truth.
I hate to say it, but that's what this country has gotten to.
That's right.
And it's for anyone that has served and given their lives, but most specifically, those that won us our freedom,
yes,
initially.
Sorry.
We were under English rule and bondage. It wasn't just about taxes and all those types of things. Religious persecution, not allowed to worship or serve God the way that God intended for us to. They finally got together and said that enough's enough and we're going to take a stand. It's time for God's people to do that once again.
Come on, brother.
Well, it might cost me my life. Yeah, it cost them their lives.
That's right.
No, I don't know if we've done this before, but I'd like us to just show respect for them that have gone before. Everyone to stand, please. Just want to have a moment of silence. And as we do, just think about those that paid the ultimate price that you and I could even be attending and standing here in a church house right now.
Amen.
If it had not been for them, this wouldn't be happening.
Sorry.
Of your Holy Spirit that I feel in this place right now. We thank you, Lord, for those that have sacrificed ultimately, Lord, that we would have the freedoms and liberties that we have. Be able to gather together to come and worship you. Lift up our voices and our hands to honor you.
Thank you, Jesus.
Help us to never, never take this for granted.
Lord Jesus.
Freedom is not free. The price was great. Most of all, we thank you for the sacrifice that you made. God, to set us free indeed.
Lord, you're worthy of that praise.
That we might be free throughout all eternity because of what you've done to give your life.
Thank you, and I praise you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord, for all you do.
We worship you today. We honor you today,
for
what you've accomplished and done for us.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Lord, I ask right now that the anointing of the Holy Ghost would fall on this place. Use me to say what you would have me to say. Help us, Lord, each and every one to do what you would have us to do, to bring honor and glory to the sacrifice that you made for us, that it wasn't in vain. We thank you today. We worship you in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Quite explain when I stand before you today, my heart is heavy.
Hallelujah. Thank you.
So heavy. I look at this country, this nation that we're living in, and I think back to how it began and what they fought for, and can't help but thinking that if those that had originally sacrificed the way that they did and fought the way that they did, if they could see us now, would they think that it was worth it? Would they be ashamed to think that I fought for things to get to this?
Yeah, so true.
Regardless of what people will try to convince and to justify, because that's what man does best. This country was founded on, our forefathers founded it on, a nation to serve God.
That's right.
Amen.
To acknowledge God in all his ways.
That's right.
To be obedient to God and to live for God.
Yes.
Just a couple presidents ago, we had a president that stood up and proclaimed, and I thought, how can he say that? But he was right. We are no longer a nation of Christians.
True.
Trying to be proud and boastful of the diversity. What a travesty.
Yes, amen.
What a shame that that statement carries any weight at all of truth. That we've gotten away from being a Christian nation. Because I understand through God's word and through studying what happens when people of God that have experienced God and have been blessed by God, what happens when they begin to turn their backs on God and walk away from God?
Yes. It's the truth.
Judgment.
The truth
comes.
Yeah.
And we're in a place that when we think about God's judgment, we think about the tribulation period. Us as Christians now, I think for the most part, think of that. And that is ultimately God's judgment being poured out. And that's after the fact that God has said, you've gone too far, you've crossed the line, now it's time for judgment. And just as it was, we've been studying Isaiah, when it happened to Israel, that there's nothing you can do to stop this now.
That's right.
Even for them to turn towards God would still not stop God's judgment from continuing during the tribulation time.
That's right.
Yeah.
Because that is the time that he proclaimed that I am now judging sin. But we need to realize that judgment still takes place today.
That's right.
We don't acknowledge it often. We don't see too many times, recognize it for what it is because of the fact that God is long-suffering, God is merciful, God is love. We want to focus on those things, and we want to put away the fact that he is still a God of judgment.
That's right.
Be not deceived. God is not mocked.
That's right.
Whatsoever you sow, that shall you also reap.
That's the truth.
Then he goes on to give hope to the believers. Don't faint.
Yes.
In well doing.
That's right.
For in due time, if you faint not.
Yes, amen.
Come on, you're going to receive.
Amen.
I think we have gotten to a place of mental defeat. I've said all along, and I believe this to be absolute truth, that one of the number one things that Satan uses to defeat individuals is discouragement. When you really believe in something, when it's really got a hold of you and it's in there, and you're willing to do whatever it takes to see that through, that's when people will go to all kinds of extents to accomplish things. But let them lose hope in that. Let them get discouraged in that. Eventually, if that doesn't change, they will give up.
That's the truth.
Yeah.
We're seeing it happen to the church and in Christianity at an unprecedented rate. People discouraged at the condition of the world and the things that are happening and what's going on in our families and our lives and the church, everything around us.
Amen.
Losing hope.
Right.
Getting discouraged. And too many people, they're giving up. And they're not, as we sung about this morning, I'm on the battlefield for the Lord. Keep on the firing line.
That's right.
What happened? What got us to this place? There's a progression of things that happens. It doesn't happen overnight.
That's right.
And we see the repetition of this throughout the history of mankind. And we're just at another stage of that. You've heard the saying of history repeating selves. It absolutely does.
Sorry.
And we're at a place of repeating history, and we don't recognize, unfortunately, too often.
Right.
Or people don't acknowledge the fact, or they don't want to think about the fact that that's even possible.
That's right.
that we could be repeating history again.
That's right.
But we are.
Amen.
I'm going to be in Romans chapter 1, if you want to turn there with me. If you're anywhere close to my age, don't have to be even as old as I am, I'm 56 years old. If you're anywhere close to that, past that, then in your lifetime you will have seen what it is that I want to talk about. You don't even have to be that old. Things have changed so quickly, so rapidly, that even teenagers can say, if they recognize it, things have changed in my life.
That's right.
I just ask for the Lord to help me to say what He would have me to say. He woke me up very early this morning and placed this in my heart. And I said, oh, Lord, that's a difficult message. People today don't want to hear this stuff.
That's right.
But He said they need to hear it.
Amen.
And there has to be somebody for him to hear it from.
Amen.
Now more than ever, we need to be the church.
Amen.
Not in name, not in social dictates, but we need to be the true church of God.
Amen.
The world, our families, our children need it more today than ever before. Hear this letter to the Christian in Rome, the letter Romans. Paul is instructing and giving knowledge to Christian people. We need to heed it. We're going to begin at verse 16. He says, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ.
Praise the Lord.
I don't know about you, but I'm not ashamed for what I believe in.
Amen.
In a time that they're trying to make everybody guilty for bringing shame to individuals. And what they're saying is, we don't want to hear about our sin. We don't want anybody telling us that we're wrong. Well, you know, that's been mankind's inkling ever since he was created.
Yeah.
Who likes to hear and be told, you're wrong?
Right.
Yes.
Nobody.
That's right.
But I'd rather be told I'm wrong than to continue living a lie.
Yes. Yes. Amen.
That's just me.
True.
Paul says, I'm not ashamed, and no matter what you say or you try to convince me of, I'm still not going to be ashamed of who I am in God.
That's Amen. Right. Amen.
I'm not ashamed today that I'm a Christian.
Amen.
I'm not ashamed today that those will call me conservative or old-fashioned or out of date or whatever word they want to put on it. I don't care. I'm not ashamed of it.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
For it is the power of God unto salvation.
Amen.
Not to anyone, but only to everyone that believeth.
Yeah.
You must believe that it's the truth and that it's the right way.
Yes.
Or it won't mean anything to you.
That's Amen. Right. Amen.
To the Jew first and also to the Greek. Here's where we get deep. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith. As it is written, the just shall live by faith.
Amen.
I'm not a Christian. I don't live the way that I do because of what I see or what I'm experiencing or what's happening in the world around me. I do it by faith.
Yes.
Because I believe with everything in me that God's word is true,
yes,
that it's correct,
Amen.
That it's the right way to live,
yes,
that it's what's going to see me into heaven.
Yes. Thank
Come
you,
on.
Lord.
I live this way by faith.
Yeah.
I trust that God instructed me correct.
Yes. Right. Amen.
Thank
For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness. They hold back righteousness. So everything that is taking place, I just have to be patient, because one of these days...
Hallelujah.
Mm.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Blessing, Lord.
Praise God.
God is going to say, enough's enough. Son, go and get my people.
Yes, thank you. Right. Amen. Thank you.
Go and get your bride that you've been waiting for all this time. It's time.
That's right.
Help
us be ready.
Thank you, Lord.
All ungodliness and unrighteousness of men. Because that which may be known of God is manifest unto them. It was shown to them. For God hath shown it unto them. God hath revealed himself to every living creature.
Yeah, that's right. Amen.
Well, I haven't been raised in church the way you were, and I haven't been taught the Bible the way that you were. Well, you're not going to be held accountable the way that I am.
That's right.
Yes, amen.
Come on.
Fact.
That's right.
But you're going to be accountable for what you do know.
Amen. Yes.
Verse 20 says, for the invisible things of him, things that we can't see or touch, the invisible things of him, from the creation of the world. I didn't see the world created, but I know it was.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right.
How it got here was invisible to me.
Yes.
They're clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Nobody's going to have an excuse.
Right.
Well, I wasn't taught that. I wasn't shown that. Well, you can see through creation itself that there is a God.
Right. Amen.
Well, I don't believe that that was caused by God. You chose to believe that.
That's right. Amen.
You're choosing a way to believe. Right. Well, I believe it was the Big Bang Theory. You saw that?
Come on.
Right.
You didn't experience it. You're choosing to believe this point of view. I choose to believe God.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Well, why? Because in everything I see design, I see order.
That's right. Yes.
Specific things that it could not have just happened by chance. It's too complex.
Right.
Absolutely impossible. I may have given this example before. I wouldn't walk across the Sahara Desert and right in the middle of it come up and there's a pinball machine that's working. And think, wow, what exploded and caused that?
Come on,
bro. Come on. No, it's too specific. The design, the features, I'd say, who put that there? Somebody is responsible for this. It's too complex. To just have appeared in the midst of all this sand. Verse 21, because that when they knew God, they knew who he was, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain or conceited in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened, professing themselves to be wise, they became fools.
That's right.
Well, what's one of the popular things that they want to give you now? Follow the science. What's the science say? I don't know. I don't listen to fools. Not my words, God's words.
Yeah.
The smarter and smarter that they claim to be, the more that they're proven to me through God's word how foolish they are.
Amen.
How much they don't know because they think they know it all. They really don't know anything.
Amen.
And when they fail to acknowledge God for the things that he's shown and given to them, then their mind is going to get darkened. And they're going to be heading down a path of darkness that they don't even comprehend or understand.
That's right.
Amen.
Verse 23, it says, and changed the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image made like the corruptible man, and to birds and four-footed beasts and creeping things. Rather than acknowledge God, they began to worship the creation. Rather than worship the Creator and acknowledge that there is a Creator, hey, somebody made the sun and the moon. Let's worship the sun and the moon.
Come on.
Hey, somebody made angels. I'm all into angels. Let's worship angels. Well, how about the one that created them?
Amen.
How about the God in heaven that is the creator of everything, the giver of life? Why not worship Him?
Yeah, that's right.
Well, why? Because they got conceited in their own knowledge and their own understanding that they thought that they had, that they begin to allow this darkness to come in. And listen, it doesn't stop there. This is the part of judgment that I'm talking about. We're in judgment now.
Yep.
As man gets further and further away of what's right and what should be understood and seen and known through God, God allows them to get deeper and deeper into that nonsense.
Yeah.
Verse 24, wherefore, because of these things, wherefore, being because of what we just talked about, because of how smart they thought they were, that they can determine between right and wrong and figure out where things came from and all of the knowledge that they think that they had, and leaving God out of it. Come on, where are we at today? Wherefore, because of that thinking, God Himself also gave them up to uncleanness. I've said many times, I don't know how long this is going to take. I always try to be quick. You know what? I'm just going to obey the Lord this morning.
Yes. Amen.
Lord.
Hallelujah.
Have your way.
How do we get to where we are? I've said over and over, if you want to see where we are in God's timetable of the return of Christ and judgment, ultimate judgment being poured out into the world, You look at this one thing, and it's the indicator of it all: sexual immorality.
That's true.
That is the ultimate place of depravity for humankind to get to when God says, "That's it."
Yep.
Far enough. Everything else that takes place, even the idolatry and all of those things, lead to this place.
Yeah.
Yes. Sodom and Gomorrah was destroyed for it. I even heard preachers stand up and say, well, that's not really true. They were destroyed because of their unkindness. You idiot, get out of the pulpit.
Right.
They were sinning.
Yeah.
Their sin was homosexuality. The entire earth was destroyed with the flood. Why? Because man's heart got to the place that he was sinful, evil, his thoughts, continually. God gave them up to this uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts. And what did it lead to? To dishonor their own bodies between themselves. Well, the Bible doesn't talk about homosexuality. It just did.
Yep.
Amen.
Yep.
It may not use the word homosexual.
Yep.
That would be an English translation.
Right.
Mm-hmm. The Bible doesn't use the word rapture. Mm-hmm. But in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye.
Hallelujah.
Come on.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Those that are alive and remain are going to be caught up with Him in the air. Well, you call it what you want to. I call it rapture.
Amen. Yes.
You call this whatever you want to. I call it homosexuality.
Yes, it is.
Feel the boldness of the Holy Ghost coming on.
Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Because they fail to acknowledge God. Let's put things in perspective and follow the timeline in our lifetimes. As science began to get better and the Industrial Revolution and the invention of microwaves, man, wasn't that something? Don't have to stand there over the oven and slave all this time. A minute, 2 minutes, and hot food.
Come on.
Well, that's nothing now. That's childish.
That's right.
phones on the wall. Anybody remember that?
Oh, yeah.
Yep, yep.
Ah, I hit the wrong number.
That's right.
Yeah, only if you're around my age can you appreciate that. The computers people could have in their homes, not ones that took up floors of office buildings. This is more powerful than any home computer I have ever owned before. Unbelievable. The advances. We're getting smart. And all along, as we're getting smarter, we're pushing God further and further away. Come on. When did we start to get to be that kind of a nation that really began to turn its back? There was a time, even in my childhood, that among anybody, Christian and non-Christian, there was a thing called morals.
Yeah.
Right.
Right. It's true.
Amen. Even non-Christian people knew it was wrong to sleep around and cheat on your wife or your husband, or to go and jump into bed with people that you weren't married to. I know I'm getting blunt, but this is the way that it is. You gotta hear it.
Amen. Amen.
Even non-Christian people said that's wrong.
That's right.
But as we begin to get smarter and smarter, and medicine increases, and the drugs and things that we can take to take away headaches and every other ailment and this thing and that thing and whatever, and medical advances, what have you. The more those things have increased, come on, we've seen it.
Right.
The further God gets pushed out.
Yeah, that's right.
Be not deceived. God is not mocked.
Right.
He didn't use me to become a free nation only to get to this. I ain't going to allow that. Wherefore, because of those things, God gave them up to uncleanness. He said, that's what you want? Go have it.
Yeah. Right.
Through the lust of their own hearts to dishonor their own bodies between themselves, who changed the truth of God into a lie. And worshiped and served the creature more than the Creator. They worshiped and served self.
Yeah,
that's
right.
Who is blessed forever. Amen. The Creator is.
Amen.
For this cause. Listen. Can you see the progression?
Right.
So they started to get involved in sin that at one time everybody, not just the church, acknowledged was wrong. Now you can't get the church to acknowledge sin.
Come on
now. That's right.
Now you can't hardly find a place to go and hear the preached word against sin.
That's right.
For this cause, because they went this route and they started to do these things, God gave them up unto vile affections or passions. Where did it happen? God allowed it to happen. This is the natural progression of sin.
Right.
Sin is never satisfied.
That's right.
There's never enough.
That's right.
When we head into a wrong direction, trying to satisfy flesh, it never happens.
Right.
For this cause, God gave them up unto vile affections. That sounds like judgment to me. For even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature.
Right.
I don't care all this nonsense that some knucklehead is trying to give across, that there's all these genders and they can't even count them all now. Listen, there's a man, there's a woman. God created it that way.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
And everybody wants to throw in the exception rather than the following the rule. But what about people that were born and they have medical issues and there's some of each and that that's not the norm. That's an exception.
That's right.
Never have we ever made rules for exceptions.
Right.
We make rules and decisions based on normality.
That's right.
Normal is for there to be a man and a woman.
Amen. Amen.
Now one of the things we hear all the time, and this is what Satan does.
Right.
He's attacking our young people.
Yeah.
Before, I hear it over and over, before somebody, they get so deep into that homosexual lifestyle. It all started out, usually as a young person, I was confused as to who I was. Well, my word says that God is not the author of confusion.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
That's right.
God made me this way. No, God didn't confuse you. He doesn't do that.
Right, right.
God didn't physically make you a boy and then mentally have you think you're a girl.
That's right.
That's confusion. God doesn't do that. He's not the author of confusion.
Amen.
Right.
Amen.
Right.
Confusion is what Satan uses to eke his way in and to mislead us, to head us down the wrong path. Well, I'm confused. Hey, here's my opportunity to sneak in there and get them going the wrong way. They're not sure. I got a chance.
Amen.
And likewise, also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust one toward another, men with men, working that which is unseemly, and receiving in themselves that recompense or reward of their error, which is meet due. Well, the New Testament doesn't talk about homosexuality. It just did.
Right.
Well, that's Old Testament where it says that man shouldn't lie with man and woman shouldn't lie with woman. I just read you New Testament.
Right.
That's right, brother.
Mm-hmm. Well, I don't see it that way. Then you're dumber than I thought.
Amen.
Amen.
Pastor, you sound angry. I am angry. There's a holy anger. Be angry and sin not.
Yes. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
I'm angry at what the devil is getting away with.
Right.
I'm angry at what the church is allowing him to do.
Amen.
I'm angry that our children are dying and going to hell.
Amen. Yes. Amen.
But we sit back and we don't do anything about it.
Right. That's right.
Help me, Lord.
Amen. Hallelujah, Jesus.
And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge. Yeah, there's still something there pulling and drawing and saying that this is wrong, this is wrong, this isn't the way to go.
Right.
This isn't natural.
Come on.
This isn't what you were created for.
That's right.
The Spirit of God is still there pulling and pulling.
Yeah.
Yes.
But when you reject that too much.
Right.
Come on now.
When you continue to go that path and not look back, and you won't hear what God is saying, then this happens.
Right.
They did not like to retain God in their knowledge. Mm. God gave them over to a reprobate mind.
Right.
To do these things which are not convenient.
Mm-hmm.
God gave them over.
That's right.
Their mind, through the continual path that they were on, the progression that takes place.
Come on.
Hey, listen, we didn't just jump to here.
Right.
It started off with they were pursuing the lust of their flesh, their own desires. Mm-hmm. Well, where did that begin? Remember, sexual immorality. It didn't immediately start off with homosexuality, fornication.
That's right.
The Bible's pretty clear on that, talks about it a lot.
Right. Amen.
Well, let's look in our lifetimes. What do they refer to as the sexual revolution? The 60s?
Mm-hmm.
Love, love, love. What did that mean? Sleep with whoever you want to. Yeah. Nobody cares, and it's all okay.
Come on.
You're being pretty blunt, Pastor. I gotta be.
Right.
You think I like preaching these sermons? I hate it.
Amen.
I'd rather be able to stand here and tell you how much God loves you and you're doing great and just keep on doing it and you're going to heaven.
Mm-hmm.
Nope.
We have to be aware of the day that we're living in and what's going on in the world around us.
Right.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Fornication. God made a man and a woman.
Mm.
And right from the get-go, he joined them together as one, husband and wife.
Right.
But to have relationships outside of that was wrong.
That's right. Amen.
Why? Because God said it was wrong.
Amen. Right.
Then we've gotten to a place, and this has happened throughout history. It's repeating in our lifetime. I'm showing it to you. In the 60s then, it became fashionable. People just shacking up.
No.
What has that gotten to today?
Yeah.
And as we see continually, once we head down the path of sin and we accept one thing, it always requires more sin.
Amen.
There's a cost involved and associated with sin. And to try to cover up or to do, we've seen it in David.
Right.
He was with Bathsheba. Shouldn't have been. He should have been out doing his business on the battlefield.
That's right.
But he stayed behind where he didn't belong. He let his eyes wander where they didn't belong.
That's right.
Now there was a child on the way. Adultery led to lying, then led to murder.
Yeah.
Yep.
To try to cover up and hide it.
Yep.
What happened in 1973? Anybody familiar with that? Roe versus Wade? Yep. Think about it. After a little over a decade, fornication. Now the reality of the price that comes along with that.
That's right.
And in order to try to cover up that sin, now we got to jump to a greater sin.
Right.
Where the federal judges pass the law that the states can't dictate whether or not they can get an abortion or not. Yeah, that's necessary after a decade of free love and unwanted kids. Think about it. And you get all kinds of arguments trying to justify that. Well, what about for medical reasons or rape and incest? Okay, for medical reasons, it really doesn't exist anymore with technology now. That is non-issue. And then for the others, the percentage is so low that it's not even an argument.
None.
You know, what studies or percentages do you believe? Well, I hardly believe any of them. You know, learned a long time ago, I heard the statement that figures lie and liars figure.
That's right.
Yep. Well, the one statistic that they all agree in, and the studies that they've done, is this. 96.5% of all abortions are for social reasons.
Oh, yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
Come on.
There you go. Oh, yeah.
So if there was any credibility to the other arguments, which there isn't, out of 1 million babies murdered, 965,000 of them were murdered because of convenience due to somebody's sin.
Yeah.
Do you think that was because of mothers that were in families and had husbands present and said, well, I just don't want any more kids? Nope.
Come on.
Social reasons.
That's right.
I'm unmarried. I don't want it. Murder for convenience.
Amen.
Why? Because there's a progression.
That's right.
We didn't start there. We started off with things that seem simple and, well, who cares about this? And it leads and leads and continues, and now here we are.
Yep. 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 Right.
Someone recently asked me the question, can a person with a reprobate mind be saved? I don't know. I believe yes. But when you read the theological definitions of a reprobate mind, it's somebody that no longer has the ability to get saved. But I know God is the one that has the final answer on that.
That's right. Amen.
Sexual sins are the hardest to overcome.
Yes, they are.
First, just came into my mind. Let's see if I can find it. I believe it's in 1 Corinthians. Six and 18. Flee fornication. Every sin that a man doeth is without the body, but he that committeth fornication sinneth against his own body. What, know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost which is in you, which ye have of God, and you are not your own? For you are bought with a price, therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. Fornication is a thing that is completely overlooked anymore.
It's the truth.
They'll just let them get up and leave the church and even be preachers in the church.
It's the truth.
It started there. And it led to here. Can somebody that has been given over, started with fornication, the sexual desires, and it led to the place where God turned them over to their own lusts, and then homosexuality begins to increase and has gotten to the place that it is today. Reprobate mind. No ability to acknowledge and to differentiate between what's right and what's wrong. It's gone. Can they be saved? Again, I say yes, but I'll ask you this. We've all been affected. We know. How many people do we know that are in that lifestyle that have come out of it? They're serving God now. There are some. How many Christians do we know that once served God are now in that lifestyle?
It's the truth.
Far more.
Yes. Amen.
Far more.
It's the truth.
It is rare. Rare to hear of somebody that has been in that kind of a lifestyle to come out of it and then serve God. Mm-hmm. It's possible, but very unlikely.
Amen.
Reprobate. Being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, malignity, whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful, who knowing the judgment of God. These are many that at one time acknowledged that these things were wrong and understood that there was a God in heaven that they were going to stand before and face judgment for these things.
Right.
But because they continued in that and they continued to reject God, and Satan has the open door to come in and manipulate however he wants to, now they've gotten to the place that they don't even understand that it's wrong anymore.
Right.
This is the day and age that we're living in. This is the world that we're living in right now.
Right.
Who's going to stand up and proclaim what thus saith the Lord?
Yeah.
Who's going to say that this is wrong? God's word is true and just and fair.
Amen.
And right.
Amen.
Who knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only do them, but have pleasure in them that do them. It's gone far beyond. We can look around and see what's happening in our world. Listen to me. Why are you preaching this? Well, I hope I already kind of explained that, but let me say even further. I look around and I see people that I love. And I feel like David looking on and saying, hey, there's a fight out there.
Yep.
Is there not a reason to join in it? Is there not a cause? My children are of an age, they're grown up now, and they make their own decisions, and I still love them just the same as I always have. But my influence isn't what it used to be. They don't listen to Dad anymore. But it doesn't stop me from trying.
Right.
Well, you've raised your kids. Your job's done. I got grandkids that I love more than life itself.
That's right.
Got grandkids that I love everything within me, and I see them. They're at different ages. And I see what's happening to them. They're going through the state of confusion.
Yep.
How is that happening? Listen, the schools are teaching it to them.
Right. Yep.
They're being indoctrinated. We send them off and pay money.
Right.
For them to teach them to be ungodly.
Uh-huh.
And I never had this stance before in the past because I didn't things were as bad as they are now. I was never an advocate for homeschooling. I thought it was unfair to the kids for them to get an education. But you know what? Education holds no candle to salvation.
Uh-huh.
If I was raising kids in school today, there is no way they would enter a school door.
Right.
No chance.
That's right.
Oh, you're a pastor. You shouldn't be standing. No, that is my job.
Amen. Right. Amen. Amen. That's true.
That's literally my job description.
Come on. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
To say what's right and what's true.
Right. That's right.
Yeah.
Amen.
This world is against you. It's against your kids. Satan is on the move.
That's right.
He's going around as a roaring lion, seeking who he may devour.
Yeah. That's right.
If somebody will stand in the gap and fight and do what they're supposed to do, he can't get away with it.
Yes, amen. Yes.
But when we do nothing, when we take no stance, when we just allow things to flow and happen the way that they're going, then it's inevitable.
Yes,
right.
He's going to devour everything in his path that he can get away with it.
Right.
It's time more than ever for the church to stand up.
Yes.
Amen.
And put on the armor.
Yes.
What is armor for? Put on the whole armor of God.
Yes. Amen.
He must be expecting us to do some fighting.
Yes. Come on.
Oh no, hide out in your church.
No.
Just say what needs to be said there and don't take it out there. Don't cause any ruffles. Mm. Certainly don't get involved in politics.
Yes.
Well, yeah, that's what's happened. That's why we're where we're at.
Right.
They've gotten God out of everything. Even out of those that are making judgment of running their country.
Yes. Right.
That's
so true.
Mm-hmm. We got what we deserved, what we allowed to happen.
That's right.
Well, it's too late. Well, it may be too late on a whole, but it's not too late for those that I can come in contact with.
That's right. Amen. Amen.
Those that I can fight for. Come on.
Right.
Our children, our grandchildren.
Yeah.
Yes.
Are under an attack that we can't even imagine.
That's
the deception that is taking place now.
Yeah.
The attack on the mind of our children, the conflict and confusion that the enemy is trying to speak in there to break them apart and scatter them.
Yeah.
Where's the church?
Yeah.
What are we doing? We can't just sit on the sidelines anymore, people.
Right.
Well, if we get involved, then we're going to become a target. My dad taught me one thing. Well, a lot of things, but... This he taught me. Son, don't ever run from a fight.
That's right.
It took me a long time to learn that. When I was little, I was afraid to fight. I really didn't know how to fight. I was never taught. Don't go looking for a fight.
Right.
Enough of them are going to find you. Mm-hmm. He's right.
That's true.
But when they come, don't run from them, because the second you do, you're going to be victim of that for the rest of your life.
That's the truth. Come on.
I don't want this fight. I didn't call for this fight. But it came looking for me and it found me.
That's right.
I can either run or I can
to stand up and fight.
That's right. Amen.
I am my Father's child. I'm going to fight.
Amen. Amen.
Stand with me, church. Are your kids, are your grandkids we're fighting for? I think they are. God creates everybody differently with what's embedded in them. We all have different callings. Maybe I experienced a bunch of the things that I did as a child. I haven't talked about this before. Maybe some. I hated school from kindergarten to last year of high school. I hated it. Back when I started in school, the dates were different. My mom must not have liked me because she put me in school when I was 4 years old. I was young. I think she wanted to get rid of me. Can't handle him anymore. Hey, you let him in school? You're going. Well, 4 years old. Well, everybody else was 5 and 6. I was a year to a year and a half behind everybody. And I was the runt of the litter to begin with. So guess who got picked on? Because they were little and younger and through the whole time I was in school. And I think that maybe God allowed that to happen to make me who I am.
Amen.
And I say this in all sincerity, that God designed me as a protector. Maybe I had to go through that to realize what it was like to not have somebody stand up for you. So as that, not only am I going to fight to the death and give my life for my kids and my family and my grandchildren, I'm going to do it for yours too. Because that's how God made me.
Amen.
If I was walking down the street and saw somebody that I didn't know getting beat up and abused, I couldn't walk by. Even if I thought the person that was doing it to them was going to beat the daylights out of me, I couldn't do it. I couldn't. It's not how I'm engineered. God didn't create me that way. I hope that there's some of that in each and every one of you as well.
Amen.
That no matter what it's going to cost, no matter what it might happen to me, no matter what circumstances it might bring about, our children are worth fighting for. And if necessary, they're even worth it to me to die for.
No.
And I'm going to do whatever it takes and go against the grain, no matter how rough and hard that is, in order to bring them the truth and to try to show them the light and to try to be a part of raising them the right way so that they know God, that they understand His Word, and when it's all said and done, that one day they make heaven their home.
Amen, amen.
That's the most important thing in the world. Nothing else matters. I want them to have a good life. I'd like to see them be successful. I'd like them to be able to be productive in life. But you know what? That doesn't matter if they lose their soul.
That's right.
So I'm asking us as we close today in prayer that everybody will be listening.
Thank you, Lord.
Find you a place to get before the Lord. Lord, times are tough.
Thank you, Lord.
Listen, I wish I could come before you and say, hey, you know what? Just a couple of weeks here and this is all going to be over. What, things are going to get better? I'd be lying. The truth of what I believe is that we've just seen the beginning. Things on every front are going to get worse. It's going to get bad. Now is the time for the church to bind together. To take a stand that should have been taken a long, long time ago.
Thank you, Lord.
I'm asking us to get before the Lord and ask Him, Lord, things are going to get tough. I see it. I know it. Your Word says that it's going to get that way. Empower me with Your Holy Spirit.
Thank you, Jesus.
Embolden me with Your Holy Spirit.
Thank you, Lord.
put in me what I need in order to lead a generation that doesn't want to be led. You're fighting against them. Your kids spend way more time with those at schools and the world around them than they do at home with you. They've got the upper hand on you. And they're not going to like what you're going to try to lead and teach them to do, because that's what the flesh does. I want what satisfies this. Lord, give me what I need to withstand that. What does Satan do? He wears us down. There is so much going on around us right now that it just keeps hitting and hitting and bombarding and getting worse and worse. It ain't going away. So the easy thing is to do is say, I give up. I'm not going to try anymore. That's what he wants. But I have to have the same attitude as it was when I was disciplining my kids. Look, I can be way more stubborn than you can. You're going to keep doing that? Well, I'm going to keep doing this. Can you have that attitude with Satan? Come on. Everybody that will, please come. Get before the Lord. Ask him for the strength. And the power and the ability to do what we need to do in these last days. It literally is now or never.
If you're in the battle for the Lord and right, keep on the firing line. If you win, my brother, surely you must fight. Keep on the firing line. There are many dangers that we all must face. If we die of fighting, it is no disgrace. Coward in the service, you will find no place. So keep on the firing line. Well, you must fight, be brave against all evil. Never run nor even lag behind. If you would win for God and the righteous, keep on the firing line. There are many dangers that we all must face. Keep on the firing line. Keep on the firing line. When we see the souls that we have helped to win, leading them to Jesus from the path of sin, with the shout of welcome we will all march in. So keep on the firing line. Well, you must fight, be brave against all evil. Never run nor even lag behind. If you would win for God and the righteous, keep on the firing line. God will only use a soldier he can trust. Keep on the firing line. If you wear a crown and bear the cross, you must keep on the firing line. Life is but to labor for the master dear, help to banish evil and to spread good cheer. Great you'll be rewarded for your service here. So keep on the firing line. Well, you must fight, be brave against all evil. Never run nor even lag behind. If you would win for God and the righteous, keep on the firing line. Well, you must fight, be brave against all evil. Never run nor even lag behind. If you would win for
Church, now it's time to get into the fight.
Amen.
I really pray and hope that you know how much I love you. Love you with all my heart.
Thank you, Lord.
Those weren't just words that I would be willing to die for you.
Amen.
Whatever it takes. I want us all to make that our home.
Yes.
If I didn't love you, I wouldn't preach messages like this.
Amen.
I would take the easy way out. But it was much easier than to preach.
Amen.
But then I'd have to stand before God and give an account.
Right.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
As much as I love you, I'm not going to help for you. Because that wouldn't do either one of us any good. And I appreciate you. Thank you for being here today. It's that time of year. I need to have the discussion once again. I've never had a problem with anybody, but it's just have to say it just to make sure that everybody understands. Summer is about to be here. It's about to get hot. We need to continue to honor God's house.
Amen.
And how we dress and how we come here.
Amen.
Our children, how we let them come here.
Amen.
We're not hanging out in the backyard at a pool party or going to the beach or any of these other things. We're coming to the house of the Lord. We're going to have service tonight outside. It's going to be warm. I'm asking you to still be respectful. No, I'm not going to wear a suit and tie, but I'll be fully clothed. You know exactly what I'm talking about. So it's still a church function. So I'm just asking you to, and again, nobody has disrespected that. Proud of everybody. But sometimes the things go unsaid, then over time people think, well, it doesn't matter anymore. Well, if it mattered 100 years ago, it still matters.
That's right. We're having service tonight. We're having a campfire service at 6 o'clock, so coming out. I've asked every family to bring a pack of hot dogs and buns, and then we'll get some stuff for s'mores and chips. And there's plenty of drinks back there. I think from the other day, we have that in the back, so I don't think anybody needs to bring any drinks. But we need hot dogs, we'll have the grill going. We need hot dogs and buns, and then you know, just chips and s'mores, whatever you want to bring. Dan, I'm sure they have cookies if you come. Just saying. So come on. Those of you that have your guitars, bring your guitars. We have a service on the campfire, so we'll be singing. We'll be come with a song. We'll be doing that.
It's very informal.
Very informal,
but not super.
We want to have a service, so come for a time of worship. We'll be doing that. Then afterwards, I'm sure they'll have the bags out there. Just come on, don't wait. I don't think everybody has work tomorrow. I don't know if they do, but most of us don't work tomorrow, so we don't have to be in a hurry. Just a time to fellowship, so we're doing that tonight. Tuesday night at 6:30, we do 6:30. Here at the church, we're having the men's meeting and the women's meeting. So we'll all get together in fellowship hall. We'll eat together, and then the men will come in here, and the women will stay in the fellowship hall, and we'll do their fellowship time, their men's stuff and their women's stuff. We'll do that. Next Saturday at 5 o'clock is our business meeting. 5 o'clock, be here. I know I say this all the time. A lot of people like to come to that. They think it's not important. Comments to see what's going on with the church. See how the Lord has blessed us. See what's going on. I know we'll be discussing some other things. So come 5 o'clock. It probably shouldn't last more than an hour or so. So just come out. And then at that time also, we'd like to get set up for the next day, which is our 10-year anniversary. So that will be a potluck. If everybody can bring food, we'll have our morning service. And then after that, I think Brother Rick Helton's going to come and preach that service for us. So. He was with us, and Hal was a big part of getting this going, so Terry just felt like he wanted to be part of it, so we're looking forward to having them with us. And then after the morning service, we'll have dinner on the grounds again. We'll just make it a day thing. We'll have some games planned, just a time of fellowship, and in the evening we'll end up again with a kind of an outside service, singing, whatever we're going to do. So that's next Sunday. Looking forward to that. Invite people if you want. God's been good to us for the last 10 years. He's been very, very good. Again, if you have any pictures the last 10 years, you can send them to me, email and text them to me. We're trying to get together a slideshow just to show some stuff, so we're trying to do that. So we have that going on. Camp applications are out. See Monica or Ezekiel. They have those for the kids that want to do that. This is something that, I don't know if the kids aren't in here, but are the kids in here?
Some of them.
All right, well, parents, listen up. So next Sunday is our 10-year. And I think it's quite, when we did our dedication service 10 years ago, we had an auction, and we raised money. We auctioned off baked goods and stuff, and we did that for our 10-year just to help get our money in our account to start over, and we did pretty good. So camp is upon us. So next Sunday, during our 10-year kids, every kid that's going to camp this week, next Saturday, you have to bake something, and you bring it, and I'm going to auction it off for your camp. So parents and people with no kids, come with your wallet. These kids want to go to camp. But they're going to bake it, and we're going to sell it. So I thought that would just, we did it 10 years ago, we're going to do it 10 years later. We're going to auction it off. Auctions are always fun, so we're going to do
that. I need to know how, now, any of you kids know how to bake?
Parents, listen, you can help those babies. I want them to do it. You help them. Sharia, I don't want no beautiful cupcakes walking in the church.
Unless the kids made it.
You can stand there with your hands high. You can help. But so yeah, just because we like the kids, if they want to do more than one thing, they can do whatever they want to do. But we're gonna do an auction. We're gonna start them off and do that. And then also, we're getting ready. Those kids are making up a resume, and they're going to hire themselves out. $10 an hour. If you got some work around your house that you need done, these kids are going to be auctioned. They're going to be auctioned. They're going to be a sign up, and it's going to be for hire. And they're going to tell you what they can do. And if you need some yard work done, or if you need your garage cleaned out like I do, and my garage is bad. So that's going to be coming up in the next few weeks.
$10 an hour.
Same as our garage.
So if you need some work done, some extra help. Listen, I feel you're going to support these kids anyway, so just get some use out of them, all right? They can work with them. So that's going to be coming up. So we've got those two things on the horizon. So that's what's coming up.
Sign up to VBS.
VBS. The only for VBS is Havana's, and we need lots of work. Sister Ronnie's been putting things together. And so I think she's going to be having a meeting here pretty soon. Get your name up on the list for what you can volunteer. We're just doing a Friday night and a Saturday, so it won't be the whole week. So hopefully that'll work out for people, so do that. And
if our adults for camp, if you guys can donate to POP, that's one of our expenses for our concession stands at night and during the day for our kids. A case of POP.
Do you want POP cans?
Yeah, we need cans. We can't do 2 liters. So we need cans. Mm-hmm. If you guys are able to, it's cheap, it's affordable. I'm not asking to go spend $100 on POP because it's crazy. If you do 5, 10, however many of you can afford, if you can stop drinking coffee just for one day, that's $5 for coffee. So, 12 cans of pop for kids.
As you can tell, we believe in supporting our kids, so we're doing what we can. So, yeah, that's what we got going on there. So, that, anybody else? Any other announcements? I think that's our DVDs. I think that's it.
Alrighty, lots to remember. Hope you wrote that down.
Can you repeat that?
Yeah. All right, let's all stand. We'll be dismissed in prayer. Come back this evening, 6 o'clock. Ready to fellowship and worship. And we got any games to bring and play some games. So just have a good time this evening.
Maybe we need some chairs.
Yeah, if you have a chair, I know there's some in the pole barn. There's chairs up there, but I don't know what shape there is. So if you have your own lawn chairs, Ezekiel text Monty and said, we're having a party in the church tomorrow. We need a chair. I think he just wanted one of those zero gravity chairs. He came home with two of them, so bring your own chairs.
All right. Billy, can you dismiss us?
Heavenly Father, we thank you, God, for your spirit fell here today. Lord, we thank you for your word. We would ask, God, that you just go with us and lead us and guide us, Lord. As you called us to be soldiers, Lord, let us put on your armor, Lord, and stand unified, Lord, as the battle rages, Lord. But we want to be ready to fight, Lord, prepared for everything. And, Lord, we know you'll supply our each and every need, Lord. Go with us and be with us in the function beyond tonight, Lord. May we glorify thee in all that's said and done. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.